In this video, we'll look at solvation. The IUPAC says that solvation is an interaction of a solute with a solvent which leads to a stabilization of the solute species in the solution. The way to think about this is that if we have a solute, let's say sodium chloride, and we put it into water, before the sodium chloride can actually be dissolved into a homogeneous solution, there needs to be an interaction between the water molecules and the ions in the sodium chloride. Similar thing occurs with sugar when we dissolve sugar in tea. The sugar is going to need to interact with the water to become solvated or stabilized in solution to make a homogeneous solution. One of the phrases you'll often hear with solvation is like dissolves like. Let's take a look at this idea. Let's look at these three possible substances. First one, sodium chloride. With sodium chloride, we need to think about what type of interactions this compound has. We know that the sodium likes to give away electrons, and the chloride will accept, so this is going to be an ionic compound. If we look at water, H2O, here we know that we have a strong dipole moment. We also have a hydrogen attached to an oxygen, so this is going to be a hydrogen bonding compound. We can also say that it is very polar because it has a dipole, molecular dipole moment in one direction. If we look at hexane, here we just have carbon and hydrogen covalent bonds. We know that because of the electronegativity difference between carbon and hydrogen, these bonds are not polar. So therefore, this molecule does not have any bond dipoles. And therefore, the molecule does not have a molecular dipole. What type of intermolecular forces would hexane have? Well, without ions, hydrogen bonding, or dipoles, what is left is London dispersion forces. If we tried to dissolve sodium chloride in hexane, there would be a substantial difference between the molecular interactions of the ionic compound and the London dispersion interactions with the solvent hexane. These are not like enough to dissolve, so therefore they do not follow the like dissolves like, and we'd imagine that if we put salt into hexane, that it would just sit at the bottom of the hexane as a precipitate. If we think about sodium chloride into water, well, we already know this one. This is salt in water. This is going to dissolve. These are similar enough, like enough, so that it dissolves. So what is the process? Well, what's actually happening with the sodium chloride is that the water is interacting with the two ions. We can think about this as the water is actually breaking the sodium chloride into its ionic character. So if we look at the sodium would interact with the partial negative of the oxygen, and the oxygen would stabilize through the interaction of an induced dipole with the ion to give us a stabilized sodium ion. A similar thing happens with the chloride, but on this side, it's going to be the partial positives that are on the hydrogens that will stabilize the chloride ion. This is the stabilization that's referred to in the definition of solvation. Here we can see the solvation of sodium chloride in water. Now, in this case, it's ionic, so it breaks into its ions. That's not always the case. If it is not an ionic compound, just a covalent compound, but we'd still have the same type of stabilization interaction. This interaction is an intermolecular forces in solution. Most of the intermolecular forces you might have learned up to this point are between pure compounds, dipole-dipole, London dispersion, hydrogen bonding. When we have a mixture, we have a few additional intermolecular forces. Those are the ion-dipole, which would be the case of the sodium ion in water, dipole-induced dipole, like CO2 in water, so carbonation, and ion-induced dipole. An example of this is the iron ion reacting with oxygen and hemoglobin. These interactions are important to whether a molecule will dissolve into the solvent. The other thing we want to think about with solvation is the enthalpy of solvation. The enthalpy of the solution is going to be equal to three enthalpy terms. The first one is the separation of the solute molecules. There's an intermolecular interaction between the solute molecules, and we have to break this interaction before we can start to create a solution. This is going to be an endothermic reaction. The second enthalpic term is going to be the separation of solvent molecules. Again, there is an intermolecular interaction between the solvent molecules, and we have to overcome this energy. This is also an endothermic reaction. The last process is going to be the interaction of solute and solvent molecules to form the solution. This will be an exothermic process. So if we look at it, we have two endothermic processes, delta H1 and delta H2, the separation of solute and separation of solvent molecules. And then we have the interaction, or the coming together, of the solute and solvent molecules to form new intermolecular forces so that we have an exothermic process. So therefore, we can think about the enthalpy of solution as one of these three possible cases. If delta H3, solute and solvent interactions, is less than that of the enthalpy for the solute-solute and the solvent-solvent, then that'll be endothermic. If delta H3 is equal to delta H1 plus delta H2, then that will be in an equilibrium. And then if delta H3 is greater than delta H1 plus delta H2, then that'll be exothermic. Often cold packs or hot packs is actually just a solvation process. Either an endothermic solvation process in the case of a cold pack, or an exothermic solvation process in the case of a heat pack. Solvation is pretty straightforward. Like dissolve like will be an important concept to remember. The scientific basis for like dissolves like is the intermolecular reactions. So whenever you see a substance, think about its intermolecular interaction. Is it ionic-ionic, hydrogen bonding, dipole-dipole, or London dispersion forces? This will help you understand whether something should be soluble or not soluble in the solvent. Practice and become confident.